In the previous lecture, we introduced the concept of a H-bridge method, and we had a look at the topology and its working principle. Now we will focus on the PUTs with modulation or PWM technique. More specifically, in this video, we will give a definition of PUTs with modulation, and we will see different techniques used in a single and three-phase inverter applications. Also, we will go through a comparison between pulse width modulation and square wave, which are among the most used operational modes for solar inverters. Pulse width modulation is a control technique that acts over the switches of the inverter. It has the aim of controlling both the frequency and amplitude of the output signal. This control is performed by modulating on-off times of the switches, therefore the pulse's width. Apart from power electronics, PWM is widely used in digital electronics and signal processing. This technique basically enables the inverter to output a periodic signal towards the AC side of the PV system once opportunely filtered out. PWM method needs a comparison between two signals. The first signal is a periodic signal that is easy to generate, or called a reference signal. Often, this signal is a triangular or a sawtooth signal. The other signal is a control signal, and it is a pure sinusoidal wave. Usually, this sinusoid is directly retrieved from the main grid signal. As already said, these two signals are compared in a time frame. If the control signal is higher than the sawtooth signal, the PWM signal in output will represent one state. If the control signal is lower than the sawtooth, then the PWM signal will be reporting another state. The two PWM states alternating over a time frame given the output signal of the inverter. To describe the different operative modes of the PWM inverter, it is useful to define the amplitude modulation ratio. This is the ratio between the reference and the control signal amplitudes. When talking about inverters, the signal considered is the voltage. It is possible to enumerate three modes of operation depending on how the ratio between input and output voltage change with the amplitude modulation ratio. The first mode is called the linear. Here, the output voltage amplitude can be modified linearly by controlling the sinusoidal input signal. Since the output voltage in its fundamental harmonic will be exactly like the input signal, in this mode the operation of full control is allowed. This mode of operation works up to the point where the amplitude of the sine signal is equal to the sawtooth reference signal. After this point, there is the so-called overmodulation region up to until the value of 4 over pi, from where the inverter starts working in a square wave mode. In this mode of operation, the output signal amplitude is 4 over pi times the input voltage amplitude. The output signal of the switch bridge is a periodic wave with a squared shape. The AC power is generated by the modulation of the pulse width. The pulse's magnitude goes from the positive value of the input, plus Vin, to the value minus Vin. As we saw in the previous video, such a time-dependent periodic output signal of the bridge can always be decomposed as a sum of sine and cosine waves. Using Fourier's analysis, the fundamental harmonic can be found. Again, all the harmonics of a higher order are disturbances that need to be filtered out before going to the inverter output. Another possible pulse width modulation scheme is called unipolar voltage switching. In this case, the switches in the two legs of the H-bridge inverter are not switched simultaneously, as it was in the bipolar scheme. In this case, two signals are then needed to control separately the two legs of the inverter. The first leg, usually called leg A, is controlled by comparing the sawtooth signal with a plus V control signal. On the other hand, the second leg, called leg B, is controlled with a minus V control signal. In leg A, when V control is higher than V sawtooth, the voltage equals the input voltage, while in the other case the voltage is zero. For switches in leg B, when minus V control is higher than V sawtooth, the voltage equals the input voltage, while in the other case the voltage is again zero. Let's see now what the results of the PWM unipolar scheme are. Once compared the signals, as I said before, we obtained the voltage on leg A compared to a neutral point. The amplitude of the pulses is either the input voltage or zero. The same result is obtained for leg B. As expected, since the negative sinusoidal signal equals the positive signal moved by alpha period along the time axis, the two pulse trains are the same but shifted by alpha of a period. The output voltage is the difference between the two voltages on the legs. In this type of PWM scheme, the variation in the output is between plus V input and zero, and between zero and minus V input. Just like the bipolar case, a pure sine can be drawn from a Fourier analysis of the output signal. This sine is the fundamental harmonic which carries the real power delivered by the inverter. The most important advantage of the unipolar PWM scheme over the bipolar one is a lower harmonic content, which translates into less signal distortion that needs to be filtered by the inverter. In applications such as uninterruptible AC power supplies and AC motor drives, three-phase inverters are commonly used to supply three-phase loads. It is possible to supply a three-phase load by means of three separate single-phase inverters, where each inverter produces an output displaced by 120 degrees. Similar to the single-phase inverters, the objective in pulse width modulated three-phase inverters is to shape and control the three-phase output voltages in magnitude and frequency with an essentially constant input voltage. To obtain balanced three-phase output voltages in a three-phase PWM inverter, the same triangular voltage waveform is compared with the three sinusoidal control voltages that are 120 degrees out of phase. A first phase controls the first leg A. Similarly, the second phase acts on the switches on leg B, and the third phase on the switches on leg C. Comparing each phase with a neutral point, a pulse train output similar to the bipolar single-phase PWM is found. Let's take, for example, the voltage A with respect to a neutral point N. As expected, the signal varies between the input voltage value and zero. Comparing now the second phase B to the reference signal, another output is found. Since the two sine waves have a 120 degrees difference, this time the two pulse trains are outphased by a third of a period. The output voltage between the legs A and B is the difference between VAN and VBN. What we obtain is the fundamental line-to-line voltage in one phase. In a similar manner, the line-to-line voltages between legs A and C and legs A and B can be found. Let's now see the main differences between PWM linear mode and the square wave mode. PWM allows us to have both frequency control and magnitude control. The former is obtained by changing the frequency of the input sine signal. The latter can be performed by changing the amplitude modulation ratio, which is the ratio between the amplitude of the input sine and the height of the sawtooth signal. The square wave mode, on the other hand, gives a higher output magnitude since the amplitude modulation ratio is constant and equals 4 over pi. This makes the peak output voltage around 1.3 times the input voltage. Also, the switches are turned on and off only once in a period, reducing the switching losses. One negative aspect of this mode is that the output wave amplitude is not controllable anymore. To recap, what we have seen in this video, the most used technique to modulate an output AC wave from a rather constant DC input is the PWM or pulse width modulation. The unipolar type acts simultaneously on the four switches of the inverter and gives a signal that goes from plus V input to minus V input. The bipolar type uses two input signals and draws in the first half period a signal that goes from V input to zero, and in the second half period a signal that goes from zero to minus V input. The PWM can be applied also to three-phase inverters to obtain three waves with a 120 degrees difference. Finally, we saw a comparison between the single-phase PWM in a linear mode and in a squared wave mode. In the next video, we will see the overall configurations of a real inverter.